Very good morning to everybody. Today we have with us a very established political leader, all the way coming from Northeast, joining us from Shillong and Meghalaya. He has been in politics since inception, and he's a self-made political leader all on his own in one of the oldest party in India, the Congress. We would like to welcome Mr. Vincent Pala, the Member of Parliament from Shillong. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you, Harsha, and thank you, Dr. K.K. Upadhyay and Sushil Kumar Sharmaji. It's nice interacting with you. And I am sure that you are all safe. Meghalaya now, as of now, Meghalaya also is not in very good position. Every day there are 25 to 30 people are dying. At the same time, almost 700-800 people have been affected every day. I hope in Delhi, Goa, not much better than Meghalaya in terms of positivity rate. We have almost, I don't know whether it's correct or not, somebody told me we have almost 38% positivity rate for the last 1 week. And there's a death of almost 100 for the last 1 week. Anyway, that's, I think we have to live and we have to fight with it. I would like also to thank the Digital Parliament for organizing such a lovely program. I'm sorry I could not make it before, and at last, I think I made it. My early life, actually, by profession, I'm an engineer. I used to work with the government of Meghalaya for almost 20 years. And then at a certain level, because when I was engineer, also, I was in touch with the president of the Congress Party. He died now, O.L. Nongthru, and Dr. D.D. Lapang, who was a five-time chief minister of Meghalaya. So they used to take me to Delhi and around India. At that time, even when I was an officer also, I was not very good as an officer. I was rather good as a politician, making friends with politicians than an officer. So one fine day, and then I think because the influence of the president of the party at that time and the chief minister at that time, I decided to resign from my job, because as an engineer, when we give work order, when we give the work and the government that doesn't have money to pay to the contractors. So I thought that I should resign and try to fight. How can we help? My dream was something, but when I became a politician, rather it was as not as good as what I thought it before. And thank God, one fine day, I think there's a call from Sonia Gandhi, I think with the suggestion from the state that I had to fight election. At that time, my resignation was not accepted by the government. And then it was accepted in the same day. And then I faxed it to Madam Sonia. Then I started my journey from, I can say that unexpectedly, I joined politics. So in my early life, actually, I used to be a very hardworking. Everybody knows in my areas and constituency, I used to be a hardworking and honest officer. So most of the contractors and even my friends who were the contractors when I was an officer, they still supported me even now as a politician. That's one of the main reasons, I think, because of hardworking and honest in work in office. That was, I think, a certificate which people make me, vote now is my third time. So I don't do much work like compared to other MPs. I think I've not done enough compared to them. Still yet to do a better job. But I think during the course of time, I think now this time, I think I should say that I'm up to a certain level compared to when I started joining. We basically as an engineer, I never do any public debate, or we strictly do in making bills, design the bridge, design the roads, design the building, not used to the lecture. So I remember first time when I joined politics, I used to give a speech in 2009. I used to give a speech only 4 minutes. So every speech, my leaders used to tell me, you don't have to speak much, but the more you speak, and the more you make mistakes. So I used to speak only 4-5 minutes, but somehow when election came, I won by a huge margin. So me, I said, I didn't know. I think mainly because of the party. So I used to involve mainly in mining. In my areas is in the East Janta Hills, mainly in mining. People survive because of mining and farming. So I also used to involve a lot, and my own have got a few, almost 100 square kilometers of mines in my areas, in different areas. And unfortunately, it was banned in 2017. It was banned by the NGT. So now I think we have stopped mining. But even it's banned by the NGT, most of the people, they support the regulate mining, actually, rather the unregulate. So I think things have changed now. People start doing not only in coal, even in limestone. There's a huge deficit of limestone, one of the biggest deficits of limestones in India. I think it is in my area. So my area is basically both limestone as well as the coal mining in area. So I involved mainly in both, in limestone as in coal. So before we used to do a mining, random mining, and in limestone as well as in coal. But today I think coal is stopped up to a certain level, but the limestone has been regulated. The government of Meghalaya has passed a law that all the mining should be regulated. So in that line. So it helps me also in terms of resources, how to come to politics. And the rest, I think, because of the goodwill of the party, of the high command, the blessings of my party workers and all, that's why I became advisor on my own. I think I have nothing except hard work and try to be honest to my voters, try to be honest to my constituency and work hard as much as possible. I'm ready to take any questions. I mean, rather, I'll take more questions than a lecture. So, Hasha, if you want to take, and Dr. K.K. Bhadia and Sushil Kumar. I've seen Neeraj is joining us, and Suresh is joining us. So I'm ready to take any questions, whatever you say. Thank you.
What are the initiatives that are being taken during the COVID times, and have you received any corporate CSR fundings as a support from for your work?
I said during the COVID, what we have done, I know MP alone, I cannot do much, but me along with the help of many of the big industrialists here in Meghalaya, in the first phase, we did, because lots of people, they cannot go to work, so we did have to give them rice and other things. So with my party workers, with the help of the church leaders, with the help of the headman here we have a system we called Darbar. So the in the village, they have a Darbar, and the headman is the head of the village, has been elected by the Darbar. So along with them, I coordinate and give rice, vegetables, whatever required. It depends on them. So we distribute masks, we distribute PPE, whatever they required, we do that in the first. Even now also, we continue the same thing. But now I think there's a problem of oxygen, since for the last 1 week, they keep on asking for the oxygen. So I'm trying to contact, but desperately, even yesterday I was calling Delhi, I was calling Kanpur, I was calling Pune, try to get for an oxygen. I did not get it. But somehow, whatever the plant, we in Meghalaya, we have not shortage of oxygen. We have a oxygen plant, but it was not running well, and cylinders was not available. So what we do with that, we try to help them to get it repaired, and we try to get the cylinders. Some of the people, they used to buy cylinders and stock at home. So what we do, that we do awareness that don't stock the cylinders at home, and let the cylinders be circulated, you know, so that, so I work together with the Department of Industries here, and to see that all the cylinders are circulated. And then at the same time, I work closely almost every day in touch with health officials who are here in the state, and with my party workers, especially the youth congress, who will do the job in the field. That's what we do as of now.
As you mentioned about mining is a core source of revenue out there. There have been instances where illegal mining is rampant around the Jhantia Hills. So what are the remedial measures for the youth affected due to the mining quarries and the displaced farmers?
Yeah, I do admit there used to be normally it was not illegal coal mining in Meghalaya. Mining was allowed. Coal mining is not allowed. I think in India, Meghalaya is the only place during the Indira Gandhi where the coal mining was allowed. It was allowed in the sense that, you know, Meghalaya is a coal place and heavy rain. So they thought that whatever coal here, you can dig it around your garden and you get coal and you burn it and you warm yourselves. That normally it become like a cottage industries at the beginning. So that systems continue for almost 60, 70 years. But later on, it became in a big way where we start exporting to Bangladesh and we start exporting to other states. So there somebody realized that the environment is depleted and then resources is depleted and the environment is damaged. So somebody filed a case, a PAL in the High Court, and High Court referred to NGT. So it stops. So at the beginning, it was not called illegal because the government collects almost 1,000 crores of revenue, direct and indirect, from the coal mining. So the government used to survive on the royalty. Almost every ton, the government used to get 1,150 rupees only in royalty and forget about the other things. So if you calculate in every truck, the government used to get not less than 20,000 in a truck only for royalty. And in a day, there are not less than 2,000 trucks of coal flying from Meghalaya, export as well as in the domestic. So a huge royalty government is getting from the coal. So it was legal before, but suddenly when the NGT banned it, became illegal. So once it became illegal, so those people who keep continuing, especially lots of laborers who are there in the jungle, they keep continue doing the illegal things. See, even now, if you see, lots of people are still doing the coal, but I think the government cannot stop it suddenly because lots of people depending on it. So I feel very bad when I see with my own eyes some of the parents, they have got their children studying outside in Bangalore, in Mumbai, and others, because the parents are minors, or maybe the parents are doing a business in coal. Suddenly it will stop. All of them have to come this side. So in that case, what we do, we start, especially I used to take initiative from my side, we should start colleges in the mining areas. So with the help of the Catholic and the Presbyterian Church, we started a few colleges in the mining areas. So now students who used to study all over India or even in Shillong, now they study, we have good colleges in the mining areas. So definitely illegal mining is still there. I've seen even use check even in papers or so. I used to raise that the government is highly corrupt and daylight robbery in terms of taking advantage of poor people. In one side is COVID, people are suffering. The other side is mining and illegal mining, and they are extracting money from them. So I personally don't support this illegal mining. I know that the society will not be able to sustain in the future if we do a mining. So I personally don't support it. But the present government, I think, is half-hearted in closing the coal.
I really appreciate your work, sir. But due to the mining, there is untreated toxic discharge from the mines, which are polluting the rivers and have majorly affected the biodiversity. Although there are huge amount of royalties that are paid, money could not replace environment, as we could see the climate change, and also Meghalaya is disaster prone place. What are the steps undertaken by you in your own constituency and Meghalaya at large to stop it and restore biodiversity?
Harsha, you are right that it really affects the biodiversity. What way I have done as a member of parliament, you know, it is not the entire East Jhantia Hills is undermining. Many other areas are not yet been mined. So we do have still certain areas where we have fresh water. So what I do with the MPLATS, with the government's state government support, we used to identify the different sources where, though before we used to get water just near the villages or near the urban, near the cities. But now we have to take from almost 10, 15 kilometers away. So now water is a big problem, especially in winter. So what we do is that along with the village, we try to get the water right from far away. And we still do suffer from water, especially drinking water is a problem. So what we also from the my MP schemes, we try to help them for the water harvesting. Wherever even we try to convince the government, now the government even in when for approval of the building and all, they need to have a water harvesting in their place. So we take initiative in such a way that, you know, we try to survive as much as possible. And definitely you are right, environment will be affected. And if we continue mining, we'll not be able to sustain in the future. We have to change. And whatever money which we already had it, I think we have to repair whatever we have done the damage. No, I know that it's not possible to repair 100%, but we can still try to do it in the long run.
Thank you, sir. That's these projects would be very helpful in times to come. And our Digital Parliament is an online platform in which we connect the political leaders with the masses and the youth. If the youth want to join you and the initiatives that you all are taking, how can they join and what are the features you would expect in an app like this?
Actually, I'm approachable anytime. I never off my mobile, you know. I'm the only man, even I sleep also, I put in silent mode. I never off my mobile. I don't have a security in my house also. If you see, they can just walk in my place. And I'm in also in Facebook, I'm also on Twitter, I'm also in YouTube. So I'm available in social media, I'm available on phone, I am on WhatsApp and anything. So whatever they want. I always encourage youth to join me. So there's no problem of joining me, whatever they want.
And in an app like Digital Parliament, what kind of features would you expect to see? In the times that we are living, everything is becoming digital. So what kind of features would you expect?
Yeah, I've seen your app. I've seen you have done a good job to try to connect people across, try to connect politicians across. So I think through this through the platform, I have not used it much compared to maybe I've seen others are using it very well. I think after you call me, I start realizing that you have done a good job, you know, and then I've been given a training when I was there in Parliament also, how to get connects with my voters, with the youth and all through the digital media and others. I think an app like yours, and it will give me a better chance to connect and a good chance for others to connect to us also, to me also.
Excellent, sir. On this note, may I request my fellow panelists to please ask their set of questions. Dr. Upadhyay, shall we start with you?
Sure. Sir, it's very good to know about the progress which you have done and the nice work you are doing. And the way you put forward is very plain and simple. My question to you in this COVID situation, since daily we know it will continue for long, the lockdown and all, what is the position of industry and especially the tourism in your area? And what are your plans for it?
Yeah, you are right. Actually, industries is almost collapsed in Meghalaya. Number one, because of most of the laborers who are working in the industries are coming from outside. With the lockdown and here, like I told you, the Darbar, the headman, they restrict movement of people. So most of the industries, except those in-house staff which they have, which they try to do it as possible. So most of the countries has collapsed in Meghalaya. Tourism is totally collapsed. Tourism is one of the, I think Meghalaya is one of the best places in the world,
yes,
if you compare. We are yet to explore it. We are yet to do it better because, you know, for obvious reasons, a small state, we don't have much resources. But we do, we started, actually after I became an MP, my first target was to connect Assam, Guwahati, Shillong, and we managed to get the national highway. So by opening a good highway from Shillong and Guwahati, and then also from Shillong to Nongstoin, Shillong to Silchar. So we have got one of the best highways in India. So that suddenly opened the tourism. So as an MP, I think what I try to, wherever I used to go, I used to tell people, before when you come to Shillong, especially the non-tribals, I think the local used to think them, you know, as the opportunists to come here and take and try to snatch away the jobs. But once we started the awareness, so now people in Shillong also welcome the tourists and all. So for the last 7-8 years, tourism is the most employer in my state. Every alternate house, you see that we have a guest house. We have the people open a guest house. The people open, you'll see OYO here and there. Hotels are coming up. But now all those hotels, many of them taking loan from the government. So that's why I'm saying that almost tourism is collapsed here. And with COVID, I don't know what alternative. We are trying to find out. So it's difficult to find out what alternative. The only way to do, we have to think, is in the long run. And I've been going around. I used to tell people that I think after 1.5 to 2 years, once the everybody will is at least 80% of the population are being vaccinated, I think then only we will be able to start the business back. Otherwise, until unless you get vaccinated, it's difficult. You will not have that confidence. It's dangerous also. And moreover, day by day, the variant changes. So only way is that we have to get ourselves prepared and ready to face it. So tourism, I think, is one way which is most affected, as well as industries.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Upadhyay, for your question. Suchil ji, would you have a question?
Good afternoon. Yes.
Good afternoon. Yes, Suchil ji.
In fact, Shillong is very beautiful, and we have seen natural beauty behind the scene. My question is, sir, as far as education goes, since you became MP, what are the special initiatives you have taken so that Shillong gets its deserving position in education?
Yeah, thank you, Sushil ji. You are very right. I think one of my core, topmost priority is to see that we have a good education in Shillong. So right from the beginning, from my MP lads, like I told you, we have almost 30,000 students pass matric every year, whereas admission in college, you have only maximum to 10,000. So 20,000, you expect people to either they stop studying or they go to what we have here, lots of colleges which were not recognized or unrecognized colleges and all. So what I do is that every district I used to give them from my plots, I used to support them. I used to announce 25 lakhs given to any community or any religion or any village or any NGOs who wants to start a college. So today we have in Nongpo, you see in Ribhoi, we have a college. Like I said, in Thariat, we have 2 colleges. In Jowai, we have colleges. And then everywhere we have a college. So I've almost more than 20 colleges has been started with my help. I used to give them 25 to 30 lakhs, and some of them I used to give them even 50 lakhs from my MP lots. But the church will spend 4 crores, 5 crores. The community, they will spend 5 crores. I remember recently there's a St. Anthony's College in Thariat. I gave them from my side 33 lakhs, and from the other Rajas Bhai MP 25 lakhs. So I was asked to come and inaugurate. When I went there, they spent almost 7 crores. So I know that initiative which I announced, that every institutions who already have, some of the institutions we have in Shillong, if they want to do outside of Shillong to give the same benefits to others, we'll give them MP lots. So that when I announce now, everywhere where you see almost every areas we have a college, so that 30,000 students which we pass matric every year, at least they can be accommodated everywhere now. So I encourage them to start college. So now my next step is not only starting college, they must have a science stream. Whenever they start college, it's easy to start arts, but we don't have science. So my latest awareness which I've given is that I'll not support only the arts, I'll support also the science. So I'm on, actually because of the lockdown, otherwise I was supposed to inaugurate one small college where they have started science only. So I try to do something which are there. Then also, you know, I set up a team in Delhi where in terms of education, whoever comes from the Northeast, incidentally, I'm the Secretary General of the Northeast MPs Forum. So we set up a team in Delhi where we'll help, we can connect with the Kashi Students Union. We can connect even, I connect even with the RSS or with the other organizations to help our students from all over Northeast whenever they want to get admission in Delhi, and also to guide them when they can study abroad. So my job is only to connect them with other agencies. So no, it's not possible MP to do everything, but we can connect them and guide them. And that's along with them, we can do lots. And I'm sure that if you want to empower our society, the only way is education is the top priority when we can empower it.
That's great, sir. Thank you. Just I have one commentary, if Harshaji, you allow?
Yeah, I'm there. No problem.
In fact, innovation and creativity is being talked a lot. And Shillong being a hilly state, a lot of opportunities there exists in agricultural field.
Mm.
There are graduates from IITs, IIMs who are engaging themselves in agriculture. So you being an engineer and served for more than 20 years in that area, you must be knowing that area very deeply and widely. So you, if you take some initiatives in this direction, youths will get a lot of employment and economy of state will move very fast.
Yeah, you are right. I did take a little bit of initiative, especially Meghalaya, you know, in strawberry, because I think the longitude and latitude is in such a way, the climate is very favorable for agriculture in Meghalaya. But because the agriculture in Meghalaya, because of the logistic is a challenge. So at the beginning, people did not do it. Like I said, once the logistic now, Guwahati is easily accessible to Meghalaya and the rest of Meghalaya, I think people start doing now, especially in terms of vegetables. Today, you know, even yesterday, I was telling to, I had a meeting with people that we should have the cold storage, all the areas where they produce. We have cabbage here, cauliflower is famous. Then we also have tomato is very famous. So what I'm planning to do in connection with certain companies from outside of Meghalaya, we're trying to set up a cold storage here in collaborations with the headman and the locality of that areas. For example, they'll go to sell it to the market. Whatever they cannot sell, they'll put it in the cold storage. So I'm tying up with some companies from Chennai, some companies from Delhi itself, from Delhi, who already experienced, I've already set up this with my MPLATs. I've already tied with them. And we'll have a cold storage everywhere. And oranges from here is very famous. And the pineapples are very famous. So we are planning to set up the every area so that whatever people cannot sell, they'll put in the cold storage and we'll organize, we'll connect the buyers to come from Guwahati or even I used to organize from UP. They'll come and buy direct. So our job is only to connect to them. We don't have mandis in Meghalaya, but people can, it is a B2B direct. It's from the farmers and the buyers direct. They can do. We can only assist them that there should not be a monopoly. So I used to get from Varanasi, from Calcutta, buyers from different areas to connect them, and they will go direct to the village. They don't have to go to here to Yaudo, or they don't have to go to the market also. So now the system has started. It is direct, people buy direct from the farmers, and they even used to give them seeds also. It's give them seeds also, because people who are organized in farming, they know what type of seeds they have to grow. So that I'm doing my job actually.
Great. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Saurabh, would you have a question?
Yes, sir. Good morning, Mr. Vincent. Really nice to know about the work that you've been doing over there, and you know, when you connected about the mining activities and all those things that have been happening. Yeah, definitely. It's a challenge that you, you know, rightly mentioned. Just to give you a little bit of background about, you know, what I do, I run an organization called Pothole Raja, and our mission is to make our country pothole free. You know, take up a lot of road safety initiatives, work with citizens, you know, corporates, government authorities to ensure that the roads are beautifully maintained so that we can avoid accidents that keep happening because of potholes and other, you know, road safety hazards that, you know, continue to happen. So in the last 3 years, we have fixed over 9,000 potholes in 9 cities, and we continue to do that across the country. What I wanted to sir know from you is, you know, I was listening to your thoughts about the mining industry, and you know, Harsha also mentioned that there's a lot of pollution that happens when, you know, mining, you know, happens. One, of course, is the effluent that gets released to the water bodies, and you know, the byproduct, which is unfortunately, as of now, there's no proper solution that is there to treat them, and unfortunately, it ends up in the landfill. Another big challenge that we have also seen is in you know, with respect to you know, the kind of pollution that happens, the air pollution that happens because of the movement when, you know, the mining activities are being taken care of, right? The big vehicles are you know, moving, and it's definitely a temporary road access which you know, produces a lot of dust, and it not only is not good for the drivers, operators, even, you know, the families and people who are living in and around that particular area as well. Sir, my question is, how startup friendly is environment over there? Because we as a social enterprise, you know, have certain solutions which we believe that can help the mining industry specifically, wherein temporary access roads can be made, and you know, it can solve the problem of a better commute in the mining area to a very large extent. So, in your view, how is, you know, Meghalaya over there, how is it, you know, welcoming for social enterprises and startups to, you know, kind of tackle the problem or come out with a solution that can help people around there and industries over there to, you know, kind of operate in a more sustainable way and, yeah, thus impacting the environment?
Thank you, Saurabh. I think you are right. Yeah, treatment of water is a big challenge because, you know, Meghalaya coal is very high in sulfur, one of the highest in the world in terms of sulfur, and is good also at the same time. So I've attended lots of conferences, but right from I visited the mining in Australia and America and many other places all around the world, to even in UK, I attended the conferences where and visit the site also, how can we help in treatment of the effluent which comes from the mining. But the mining all over the world is totally different from Meghalaya. Here, we destructions to the environment is compared less, whereas the discharge effluent is very high because the mining is called, in systems, is just a small tunnel. They normally call it a rat hole mining. You know, you destroy the environment, especially the surface, only by 4 feet by 4 feet, you go deep, and then you go like, you know, you go horizontally. So very less destructions to the surface, but maximum destructions to the water bodies. So when you pump the water, especially we do mining here 8 months in a year, when you pump the water to treat that sulfur, I think it's a challenge. So, and another challenge is have because here it rains heavily in summer and this totally stops in winter. So even I've seen lots of technology which I personally invited from all over the world, right from Korea, from Japan. They used to come to Meghalaya, met me, and then try to give the solution for treatment of the sulfur here. But this heavy metal is difficult to treat here. The only way is we have to do is that we have to minimize it only. So it's a challenge, you're right. For the potholes, I think the Honorable Minister Gadkari has given assurance in the floor of the house one day when I asked him a question. He said that what they're planning, that they have got a lot of toll gates here and there. So they should not collect money until unless you get a free potholes. So I think the startup which you're planning, I'll be very happy to join with you. Here in Meghalaya, one thing in Meghalaya, you know, in the areas in the mining is there, we don't depend on the government for making roads. What we do, we collect all the miners together, because most of the mining in the rural areas or in any areas is private here. There's no government mining, not a single government mining. So the government only takes royalty from us. What we do, we use, suppose there's a road of 20 kilometers which we used to do. So we collect around 20 of the, they call Maliks, owners of mines and traders. So we say 1 kilometer each. So everybody will make a road for 1 kilometer, and this 1 kilometer, there's no compromise. And whatever trucks coming from 0 to 20 kilometers, they will be, will take coal from them. Either we take, you know, we have a coal belcha. Either we take a one box or in a belcha or something. So when with that coal only we sell, and we try to repair the road. So making roads, so here, even in summer, you see all the minings here is motorable. We don't have a problem. It's not like I've seen in many other mining areas in Jharkhand, in Orissa, and others. I visited those mines. I see very difficult for them. But here in Meghalaya, in that line, you know, in the mining areas, you see there's no problem of the road. Of course, when I say no problem, it's totally that no problem. But the construction of the road is done by the local people, and the money which we get from mines, so the revenue from the mines only, which we do. So in certain areas where there's no coordination amongst the miners, they do have a problem. What you said for startup friendly in state, Meghalaya is highly educated. If you see my constituency, in terms of literacy, we are higher than the average literacy in India. Working in a tribal area definitely is a challenge. But if you come here, you come with a system, the moment you come here, try to connect with the government, get all the permissions, get all the, you know, your system properly organized, there should not be, a problem. Lots of people who work, be in America, be in Delhi, be in Mumbai, they do have a problem at the beginning. But once you are accustomed with the system, once you know the system, I think Meghalaya is one of the most friendly places in India, which I've seen. So you can come here, you can always connect, and you can help us. Not only in terms of potholes, we can do lots of things in line with what Sharmaji has said. Agriculture has got a huge scope here, because whatever you put, and it will grow here because of rains and water. There's not a problem in summer. So that is what we can do. We can coordinate. Turmeric, we have one of the best in the world, which we can really do it well. If you bring people from there, I can give my families are now start cultivating turmeric, but they don't know where to sell it. Turmeric is one of the main, you know, it has, only in Meghalaya we have the curcumin index is almost 9.4, 9.5% of curcumin. The rest of turmeric is hardly 4.3, so double the curcumin which they if they have in other parts of the country. So that's one. Orange. In Meghalaya we have a sweet orange, I think one of the best, which we used to export to Bangladesh. But now I think after mining, so these people start forgetting orange. So mining is almost stopped now. People has gone back to orange groves now. You see new orange groves are now started coming. So many things, new things are here. You can guide us with your startup. And the startup is only to connect the farmers. We don't have to teach them. They don't know how to, they know how to farming. We have to give them seeds and connect to them for the market. I think that's what we need in Meghalaya. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Saurabh.
Yes, sir. That was really insightful, sir. Of course, you know, it gives us also a lot of positive vibes that, you know, we can help the country, the entire nation to, you know, kind of have better infrastructure. Of course, you know, one thing that I forgot to mention is our technology of, you know, tackling this problem is completely by using recycled waste plastic. So we make roads from recycled plastic material. That is one of the most innovative technology in the country as of now. So again, you know, when you mentioned that a lot of rain happens over there, because it is plastic waste, it has no impact on water. So it provides a better, you know, infrastructure, motorable condition all throughout the year. So would love to connect, sir, after this as well, and see how can we, you know, also do something meaningful for Meghalaya as well.
When you talk about plastic, you know, we have here at Dalmia, we have a cement factory in Dalmia. One is in Assam, one in Meghalaya nearby. So Dalmia, they have one small plant which they burn, they convert the all the plastics, bottles and other plastics, they convert into fuel. I think what, I don't know, I've not seen the system, but I've seen they've collected a lot from Meghalaya and taken it to Assam. So they have just recently, I met the director of the Dalmia and all, tried to help get from CSR. Then he told me about this. Then I've seen the tweets by the chief minister also. So I think they are doing something in recycle here. So, and they convert the plastics into fuel and they make some sorts of energy out of that. Yeah. Thank you.
Wonderful, sir. Thank you so much for your presence today. May I request all of you all to please switch on your camera so we can take a good picture.
Thank you. Thank you, Padhyaji. Thank you, Sharma. Thank you, Saurabhji. And
you,
special
thank
you, Harsha. Thank you very much. And yes, whenever you come to Shillong, let me know.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Whenever we are in Shillong, we know that we will come to see you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Please come. Do come. Thank you. Thank you. So, can I leave?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for joining.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Saurabh, Sushilji, Dr. Upadhyay.
Thank you, sir.